Thank you. That concludes First Minister's questions. The next item of business is a debate on motion 4716 in the name of Nicola Sturgeon on the Queen's Platinum Jubilee. And before we begin the debate, I'd like to put on record the congratulations and best wishes of the Scottish Parliament to Her Majesty the Queen on the occasion of her Platinum Jubilee. Her Majesty has served the country with dedication for over 7 decades, and as we recognised at the opening ceremony for this session last October, Her Majesty has been no stranger to this chamber. From the reconvening of the Parliament in 1999, she has joined us to mark every session, and we are very grateful for her ongoing support. And it's fitting that the Parliament has this opportunity to record our respect and gratitude for a lifetime of service, and I call on the First Minister to speak to and move the motion. First Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I am very pleased indeed to move this motion in my name. Her Majesty is, of course, the first British monarch in history to celebrate a Platinum Jubilee. For her, that marks 70 years of dedicated public service, which by any measure is an extraordinary achievement. This Jubilee is therefore a hugely important personal milestone for the Queen, but it is also an occasion of historic significance. It will be marked over the next 4 days across the Commonwealth, throughout the UK and around Scotland. I will have the privilege of attending on behalf of the Scottish people the special Thanksgiving service in St Paul's Cathedral on Friday morning. And it is, as you have just indicated, Presiding Officer, fitting that this Parliament today adds our voice to the many tributes being paid. The Queen has been a very good friend to our Parliament for the past 23 years. The mace before us here in the chamber, which of course was her gift to mark the Parliament's re-establishment in 1999, is inscribed with the words integrity, justice, wisdom, compassion. It is a treasured symbol of the values that underpin this institution and which guide those of us privileged to serve here. Since 1999, Her Majesty has addressed this chamber on several occasions. Most recently, last October, she reminded us of our responsibilities, particularly in the face of the climate crisis, to help create a better, healthier future and to make particular efforts to engage with young people as we do so. Her regular visits to Holyrood, both to this chamber and, of course, to her residence across the road from here, reflect the fact, as indeed she noted when she first addressed us, that Scotland occupies a special place in her affections. Her love of Balmoral is very well known. Her first ever public engagement was at Aberdeen Sailors Home in 1944. When she visited Scotland 7 decades ago, following her accession to the throne, tens of thousands of people turned out to welcome her. Since then, Her Majesty has played an integral part in the story of modern Scotland. In the past decade alone, she has helped mark many important occasions here. She opened the Glasgow Commonwealth Games in 2014. In 2015, on the very day she became the UK's longest-serving monarch, she officially opened the Borders Railway. In 2017, she opened the Queensferry Crossing, exactly 53 years to the day after she had opened the Fourth Road Bridge. At all of these events, it was very obvious just how much public affection there is for her, and also was for the Duke of Edinburgh, whose loss last year will, I am sure, be very keenly felt by her over the coming days. One of the Queen's most recent duties relating to Scotland was for COP26. While she was unable to attend the summit in person, she contributed a thoughtful video message calling on world leaders to show leadership. I was very struck that evening in Kelvin Grove by the obvious attention and regard that her remarks commanded from all those present. It was a mark of how widely the Queen is respected, not just across the Commonwealth, but in countries right around the world. It is not surprising, therefore, that her Jubilee is being celebrated so widely. Here in Scotland, Thanksgiving services are being held in many locations, including at Glasgow Cathedral on Sunday. Tomorrow night, Jubilee beacons will be lit across the country, and in many places, pipers will play a specially composed tune. Communities across Scotland will take part in a variety of different ways. The Scottish Government, on behalf of the people of Scotland, will mark the occasion with the presentation of two personal gifts to Her Majesty, a bottle of limited edition Johnny Walker whisky with a design celebrating Scotland's plants and wildlife, and a throw made from the tartan commissioned in honour of the three bridges across the Forth. And to create a longer-term legacy, Historic Environment Scotland will plant a stand of 70 native trees in Holyrood Park. The proposed Jubilee Wood will be located less than a kilometre from here, just across the road from St Margaret's Loch, and will be visible from the Palace of Holyrood House. It is expected that wildflowers will be planted beneath the trees by primary and nursery children from nearby schools. This initiative will enhance a part of our capital city that the Queen knows and loves. It is also, Presiding Officer, historically apt. The Queen's first public engagement in Scotland after acceding to the throne 70 years ago saw her plant a cherry tree by the entrance to Canongate Kirk, and that tree still stands there today. It is hoped that the trees planted this year for her platinum jubilee will still be standing and flourishing 70 years from now, and indeed for many years after that. They will be an enduring and fitting reminder of a unique occasion in history, and an expression of the regard and affection in which the Queen is held by so many across our nation. Presiding Officer, we were reminded of Her Majesty's sense of service very recently in the example she set for all of us during the pandemic. In her public address during the first lockdown in April 2020, when she said that better days would return and that we would all meet again, she provided a comforting message of reassurance to an anxious and unsettled population. And of course, none of us will ever forget the deeply moving image of the Queen at the funeral of the Duke of Edinburgh, her husband of 70 years, undoubtedly an image for the ages, as she demonstrated yet again her determination to lead by example. She affirmed on that day, as she has done throughout her reign, those core values of integrity, wisdom, justice and compassion. The Queen has upheld those values for more than seven decades now. She has been a constant figure in an ever-changing world, and she has provided support and encouragement to many over the decades. One of the great privileges of being First Minister, in common with my predecessors and with Prime Ministers over the past 70 years, is spending time with her privately. These conversations are, of course, rightly confidential, but it is fair to say that the opportunity to talk with her and to benefit from her knowledge, wisdom and unique perspective on modern history has been an experience that I deeply value and will always cherish. Presiding Officer, it is, of course, the case that there are, and always have been, different views in our country, indeed in this chamber, about the institution of monarchy. And the democratic right to express those views is always to be celebrated. But the occasion of the Platinum Jubilee is not just about an institution. It is, above all, about the life and service of an extraordinary woman, someone who had no more choice than any of us do about the circumstances into which she was born, but who has given a lifetime of dedicated service. We should all pay tribute to that. And so it is absolutely right that we celebrate the Platinum Jubilee of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth. Let us congratulate her warmly on a reign of unprecedented length, and let us acknowledge with deep gratitude and respect her dedication to duty. Presiding Officer, it is a pleasure, and indeed it is my privilege, to move the motion in my name.
Thank you. And I now call on Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and it's a great pleasure for me to speak for the Scottish Conservatives in recognition of the Queen's Platinum Jubilee. The Queen has been the great constant in our nation's recent history. Less than one in seven Scots have lived during the reign of another British monarch. And as we recognise the Queen's 70 years of service to the British people, we reflect not just on her reign so far, but also on the changes she has seen to our country and the role of the monarch in the United Kingdom today. The Queen came to the throne in 1952 at the age of just 25, following the passing of her father. and at that point the UK was still recovering from the devastating impact of the Second World War. Rationing was still in place. Conscription continued, with British servicemen fighting in the Korean War, and the NHS was just 4 years old. Winston Churchill was the Prime Minister during the first years of her reign, and the Queen has seen 14 incumbents of that office. Yet the beginning of her reign was not just important here in the United Kingdom, it also had great significance across the globe. At the time, the UK ruled over a colonial empire with territories on every continent. And when the Queen was coronated, she was not just made the head of state of the United Kingdom, but also of 6 other countries. Today, the Queen is the monarch of 15 countries, including Canada, Australia, Papua New Guinea, New Zealand and Jamaica. She also succeeded her father as the head of the Commonwealth. And her role as leader of the Commonwealth and the influence in shaping the destiny of that organisation is one that we must celebrate when we reflect upon the Queen's reign to date. She presided over the transition of the British Empire into the Commonwealth of Nations, continuing the work done by her father to develop the Commonwealth from an informal association of former colonies who shared a monarchy to an international organisation of 54 countries, many of whom are republics. An organisation that has, of course, promoted democracy, human rights and the rule of law, including challenging apartheid in South Africa and Mugabe in Zimbabwe. Yet the significance of the Queen's reign is not just important for the Commonwealth, but for many, many other countries as well. Because the Queen is an international stateswoman. She is the most travelled head of state in history. She's visited the United States several times to reaffirm our special relationship and has addressed the United Nations twice. And many of her state visits have marked important moments of history as well. In 1980, she became the first British monarch to undertake a state visit to the Vatican, and this was followed up in 2000 and 2014 with subsequent visits. In 1994, she visited Russia in the aftermath of the collapse of the Soviet Union. And I think one visit that stands out in a long list of landmark occasions was her state visit to Ireland in 2011. An act that would have been unthinkable at many points in her reign was symbolic of the healing of old wounds both in Ireland and between our two countries. However, the Queen has not just marked significant change abroad, but also here at home in the UK, and had a huge influence on our national life. From great achievements, her silver, gold, diamond and now Jubilee celebrations, marking her as the longest serving British monarch ever. Her starring role with James Bond in the opening ceremony of the 2012 Olympic Games, and in modernising the monarchy so that it reflects the United Kingdom today. But also to personal tragedies, the Queen's uncle Lord Mountbatten being assassinated during the Troubles, the death of Princess Diana, and of course, as the First Minister has referenced, the death of her husband Prince Philip last year after a long and loving marriage. All moments not just of royal history, but also of British national history. The Queen has been a constant presence during these times of adversity and triumph, reflecting the mood of our country. From celebration and worship during her annual Christmas address to the stoicism and resolve in the face of crisis, most recently, as the First Minister said, in her televised appearance during the COVID pandemic. And of course, remembrance of our nation's sacrifices in conflict, an act that Her Majesty pays very special significance to, having lived through the Second World War. Yet as we celebrate the Queen's reign today, we must also reflect on her role in our country today. She remains the most recognisable and persuasive advocate for the United Kingdom abroad, and a symbol of our enduring ties to so many countries around the globe. And she continues to dedicate her life to duty to our country. Our country, Scotland and the whole United Kingdom, is richer because of her dedication, her passion and her commitment to the people she has served and continues to serve. So it is my pleasure, on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, to thank Her Majesty for her service to Scotland, to the whole United Kingdom and the Commonwealth. Long may she reign over us.
Thank you. I now call on Anna Sarwar.
Presiding Officer, on behalf of the Scottish Labour Party, I extend my congratulations to Her Majesty the Queen as she celebrates her Platinum Jubilee, and I pay tribute to her remarkable public service for more than 70 years. I join others in sending my very best wishes to Her Majesty at this special time for her and her family. This weekend is an opportunity to reflect on the Queen's extraordinary dedication to our country and its people. Her commitment has earned her respect and love of people here in Scotland, across the UK and across the world. Our country, our world, has changed beyond recognition since the 1950s, but one thing has remained constant during those turbulent times of change, and that is Her Majesty's dedication to duty, her integrity, her warmth and her selfless service to others. They are values which she lived by when ascending to the throne, and they are values which she lives by today, despite the many changes and challenges she has faced and our country has faced. They are values as relevant today as they have always been, perhaps more so than ever, in these times when we face division, cynicism and a worrying loss of trust in public institutions. And the importance of recognising public services and public service unites us all in this chamber. Many of us have had the honour of hearing the Queen address this very chamber. Some were even at the other end of the Royal Mile in 1990, when she opened the Scottish Parliament with the words, "It is our solemn duty, with the eyes of the country upon us, to mark the point when this new Parliament assumes its full powers in the service of the Scottish people." An important reminder then, as today, that despite our many political disagreements and arguments, all of us here are in the service of the Scottish people. This coming weekend, the shows on our TVs will look back at the Queen's remarkable reign, but this Jubilee is about much more than looking back at history. It is also an opportunity to look at our country today. So while many will be working hard this weekend, particularly our frontline workers, I hope everyone has an opportunity to enjoy the celebrations and spend some cherished time with our loved ones, cherished time that many of us didn't get through those difficult past couple of years. This weekend also marks National Thank You Day, when we can say thank you not only to the Queen for her service, but to everyone who has helped us through the difficult times we have faced in the past few years. From the nurses and doctors, to the scientists and teachers, and to our neighbours, our families and our friends. And I know many will take a moment to remember those they lost during the pandemic. As has been referenced already, at perhaps one of the darkest times in our United Kingdom's modern history, Her Majesty found the words to pull together a nation and remind us that we would meet our loved ones again. The Queen herself is no stranger to the grief felt by millions, so encapsulated in that striking photo of her sitting alone at her beloved husband's funeral. There are some who say Scotland and the United Kingdom's best days are behind us. I believe they are wrong. Our best days are ahead of us, and together, as we celebrate, we can build the social bonds of a better union that celebrates the values of Her Majesty and these islands: duty, integrity, warmth and selfless service to others. So on behalf of the Scottish Labour Party, I wish Her Majesty a wonderful Platinum Jubilee, and I wish her the best of health, happiness and strength in the years to come. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. It is a singular honour to rise for the Scottish Liberal Democrats to offer our congratulations to Her Majesty on the occasion of her Platinum Jubilee. This is a very special time. None of us shall ever again see another Platinum Jubilee. It is absolutely fitting that we mark it in this way. Presiding Officer, I'd like to begin this afternoon with a quote, if I may. "I have, in sincerity, pledged myself to your service, as so many of you have pledged to mine. Throughout all my life and with all my heart, I shall strive to be worthy of your trust." Those were the words of Her Majesty the Queen, spoken on the occasion of her coronation day in 1953. It is self-evident how hard she has strived, and even amongst the most ardent Republican hearts in this chamber, she has been found worthy of our trust, and we thank her for fulfilling the promise of those words. Presiding Officer, we live in a world and we work in a parliamentary chamber that is filled often with hyperbole, where actions and events are often spoken of in terms that overstate their importance and their significance. But today it is fitting that we reach for loftier language to sum up what has been 70 years of remarkable service from a genuinely unique and historic figure. It is right that we mark her long service, both in the Chamber today, but with the festivities that are planned across the country over these coming days. During the Queen's reign, we have heard she has seen 14 Prime Ministers come and go, and she has met with 13 of the last 14 US Presidents. She has represented this country and the Commonwealth around the world with unfaltering poise and with distinction. Indeed, in a world that can sometimes seem sadly and increasingly defined by shallow self-interest, Her Majesty has long served as an exquisite example of the best of Britishness: humility, service, dedication to duty, dignity and forbearance. She has been a pillar of comfort and of reassurance during times of uncertainty and of emergency. Whether that be as a young princess broadcasting to the world during World War II, when she ascended to the throne of post-war Britain at the age of just 27, or indeed, as we've heard already, with her recent intervention in the early days of the pandemic, when her broadcast, normally reserved for Christmas, provided a desperately needed sense of hope and perspective amidst the darkest of days. And to quote some of her words that day, "Together we are tackling this disease, and I want to reassure you that if we remain united and resolute, then we will overcome it. We will be with our friends again, we will be with our families again, and we will meet again." The Queen has always held Scotland close to her heart. Indeed, in this very chamber, just last year, she spoke of her deep and abiding affection for our country. Over the next few days, Scotland will give its own tribute to the Queen, with events planned in our many towns and cities and villages. There are those who have argued that the money spent on celebrating the Jubilee is unjustified, especially amidst the cost of living crisis. I do have some sympathy for that perspective, but, Presiding Officer, we must remember that these festivities also mark and commemorate a chapter in our nation's story, who we have been, what we have stood for. These past 70 years will be acknowledged and celebrated this weekend. That is invaluable, and I hope it serves to unite us. After 2 years of isolation and at a time when we face more uncertainty and more challenge. In concluding, I'd like, on behalf of the Scottish Liberal Democrats, to thank Her Majesty for her incredible long years of service and to wish her the very happiest Platinum Jubilee. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on the Queen's Platinum Jubilee 2022. There'll be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business.